Hello everyone, I am Giulia Preti and today I will present our work on trust decomposition of syncytial complexes.
The notion of trust was originally introduced in the context of graphs. Graphs are data structures used to model relationships between entities. Here on the left, we can see co-authorship relations among authors, and on the right, the graph representing these relations. Nodes indicate authors, and edges connect authors that wrote articles together.
There are, however, situations that the graph model fails to represent properly, due to its limited expressiveness. As an example, the article P1, written by four authors, will be represented in the same way as the group of four articles below, which are written by subset of the same set of four authors.
A more expressive alternative to graphs are the syncytial complexes. Syncytial complexes can model relationships between multiple entities at a time. Each relation between Q plus 1 entities is called a Q-simplex. Its subset of a simplex is called face, and a Q minus 1 face is a coface. As an example, the dotted triangle on the right is a 2-simplex. Each vertex and each edge is a face of the triangle, and the edges are the cofaces. The set of cofaces is also called a joist. And finally, we note that complexes are special kind of hypergraphs that satisfy the Dowan closure property, meaning that if a simplex belongs to the complex, then all its faces must belong to the complex as well. According to the complex model, the group of four papers in the previous example is represented as a group of four closed triangles, while the four author paper is represented as a tetrahedron.
As mentioned before, we are interested in the task of trust decomposition. In the context of graphs, trusses have gained a lot of attention from the data mining community, mainly because they are cohesive subgraphs and they are easy to compute. A K-truss is defined as a set of edges that form at least K triangles with other edges in the truss. And truss decomposition is the problem of finding all the non-empty trusses of a graph. We can extend the notion of trusses to the realm of complexes by considering higher order structures in place of triangles. So, a K-truss in a syncytial complex becomes a set of simplices that form at least K joists with other simplices in the truss. As an example, given the complex on the right, we can find the syncytial one truss on the left, which consists in the set of four triangles that together form the joist of the tetrahedron, and the set of four edges at the bottom, which form the joists of the two triangles in the complex. However, while the graph truss decomposition is an easy task, the truss decomposition of syncytial complexes is challenging in both space and time, due to the combinatorial explosion of simplices that we need to examine, which is caused by the Dowan closure property of the complexes.
Therefore, we identified the three properties of the syncytial trusses that we use to develop an algorithm able to deal with the time and space complexity of the problem. The first one is the a priori property, which tells us that the trussness of a Q-simplex is not greater than the trussness of its cofaces. Then, the upper bound to the trussness of a Q-simplex is given by the number of joists containing that simplex. And finally, the lower bound to the trussness is given by the largest simplex containing that Q-simplex, and in particular, it is the difference between their sizes. So, thanks to the a priori property, we can adopt a bottom-up approach that examines simplices of increasing size and discards those with trussness zero, and hence prune the search space. Then, given the upper bounds of the simplices under examination, we can adopt a peeling approach similar to the one used in graph truss decomposition, and remove the simplices from the complex in increasing order of upper bound. Finally, thanks to the lower bounds, we can avoid examining simplices with lower bound equal to the upper bound, and moreover, we can discard from the solution all the simplices with trussness equal to the lower bound. This is because the lower bound can be computed in polynomial time, and so we can compute these trustness values afterwards if needed, and removing these simplices from the result allow us to obtain a more compact set. To obtain the upper bounds, we need to find all the joys to which each simplex belongs. This operation is complicated by the number of simplices we need to examine. To solve this problem, we store the simplices in a dynamic inverted index, such that simplices that can belong to the same joys are hashed together. Since each Q-simplex shares exactly Q vertices with any other simplex in the joist, we use hash codes of size Q. So, for example, when examining sigma 1, we find that sigma 2, sigma 3 and sigma 4 share a code with it. However, as we can see from the figure, not all of them belong to the same joist. In fact, the subset formed by sigma 1, sigma 2 and sigma 3 form the joist of the dotted triangle, while sigma 4 does not form any joist with sigma 1. Therefore, once we have the group of simplices sharing a code with a given simplex, we need to determine which subsets form a joist. We do so by extracting subset of simplices sharing a common vertex W and then checking if the size is Q plus 1. Going back to our example, we create two subsets, the first one with sigma 2 and sigma 3, because they share the vertex 4, while the second one only with sigma 4. Only the first subset satisfies the size constraints, and therefore we have only one joist. Due to time limitations, I won't explain the algorithm further, but more details on the implementation can be found in the paper. I will now present some experimental results. We evaluated our algorithm on datasets with different characteristics, with the goal of showing the significance of the simplicial truss composition versus the graph truss composition, evaluating the scalability, and giving a topological and geometrical interpretation of the results. Regarding the significance of the simplicial truss composition, here on the left we can see the sizes of the simplicial trusses, while on the right we can see the sizes of the trusses obtained in the standard truss decomposition of the graph projection of the complex. The additional elements in the simplicial trusses are the higher order structures that exist in the complex. These structures are lost when adopting the graph model, but give rise to fine-grained trusses if taken into consideration, which in turn allow more detailed analysis of the data. In these charts, we can see the running time of our algorithm for two datasets, DBLP and Enron, and in particular, we can see the time required to perform each step of the computation and for each iteration. These steps are the generation of the simplices to examine via extension of the simplices retained in the previous iteration, the computation of the candidate joys, the validation of the joys, and the computation of the trustness values. The bars indicate the number of simplices to examine in that iteration. As the simplex size increases, the number of simplices increases as well, due to the downward closure property. This, in turn, increases the running time of the steps. However, as we can see, despite the DBLP is much larger than Enron, the running time is far smaller. This is due to the fact that the dimension of the simplices in Enron is larger and their overlap is lower, which means that the number of simplices to examine increases faster with the simplex size. And in particular, by looking at a number of simplices of size 5 in Enron, we can see that this number is almost 3 times larger than the corresponding number of DBLP. Before showing the topological interpretation of the simplicial trustness, we give some preliminary definitions. More information can be found at the link at the bottom of the slide. Persistent homology is a tool used in topological data analysis to detect qualitative features in complex data. The data is analyzed at different resolution scales, with the goal of finding which structures persist through the process. The most persistent structures are the qualitative features of the dataset. The zero-dimensional features are the connected component. The one-dimensional features are the holes or also cycles, and the two-dimensional features are the voids. Here, for example, in the first step of the process, persistent homology identifies two connected components. In the second step, the two connected components merge and form a single connected component. In the third step, a hole appears. And finally, in the last step, the hole is filled and a single connected component remains. This connected component is the qualitative feature of this dataset. The result of persistent homology can be visualized via a persistent diagram, where each feature is a point and the coordinates indicate the birth and death time of the feature. The diagrams in this slide present the results of persistent homology when using the simplicial trust decompositions of different subsets of DBLP as underlying processes. The topological features identified can be used to characterize and compare the dynamics rising among the entities in these two networks. As we can see, in contrast to the physics diagrams, the machine learning diagram presents points in the upper left corner. These indicate features with long persistence and thus indicate that many machine learning researchers frequently collaborated in subgroups, but never together. On the other hand, the fact that most of the points in the physics diagram are located in the upper right corner indicates that physics researchers tend to collaborate only in small groups and that they do not often cross-collaborate. Finally, we can see that the whole diagonal in the machine learning diagram is full of points, and this indicates that the co-authorship relations in the machine learning field have heterogeneous sizes. In contrast, the sizes of the collaborations in the physics field are more homogeneous. The geometrical interpretation of simplicial trustness is given in terms of manifolds. Manifolds are an important class of topological spaces, with various applications in mathematics, but also in network analysis, as it has been shown that the geometry of a network affects its dynamics. A topological manifold is a space that resembles a Euclidean space in each point. For example, the sphere is a two-manifold, while the two cubes connected by a corner are not a manifold, because the connection point has not a Euclidean neighborhood. For more information about this topic, please see the link at the bottom of the slide. In simple words, a simplicial manifold of dimension D is a simplicial complex generated by a growing process that adds a D simplex at a time, using one of its cofaces. As a consequence, we can deduce that each Q simplex in the simplicial manifold has trustness D minus Q. Thanks to this observation, we can use the simplicial trust decomposition to quantify how much the dataset deviates from a manifold. In these plots, we can see the number of simplices per simplicial trustness value, where different colors indicate simplices of different sizes. The more diverse are the trustness values of simplices of the same size, the more the datasets is different from a manifold. As you can see, the financial datasets ATF is more similar to a manifold than DBLP, because almost all the simplices of the same size have the same simplicial trustness. This concludes the presentation. I will address your questions at the Q&A session. Thanks!